today. Okay, so we have before us the agenda. Has the agenda been posted?
It has, and certified by the clerk. It was an adjustment to agenda item 6 that was sent after the agenda went out. When we get to that item, it was a small change. Other than that, Mr. Chair, we're good to go.
Okay, the agenda is before the board. Okay. There's a motion and second. Any discussion? Any objection? Without objection, the agenda is approved by unanimous vote. Which item 9, Beacon Coastal Study.
Yeah, thank you, Mr. Chair. We're lucky to have U.S. Geological Services. Dan Hoover is with us. He gave a presentation to us a number of meetings back. We asked Mr. Hoover to come after the recent floods and sediments onto the beach, just a general overview of what the U.S. Geological Survey has been able to determine in the last few months.
Yeah, thanks for the invite. As you mentioned, I was here May of last year to give you an overview on everything we've been doing in the Santa Barbara Littoral Cell since 2005. This won't touch on the big stuff. This is more focused on what we did after the fires and after the mud flows. So I'm happy to talk about all the other stuff offline. So these are just a few pictures. We've got lots and lots of pictures. This was sent to me by the State Park staff down in front of Carpentier Creek. A lot of debris came out there. Next one. This was an interesting one to me when I was surveying on the beach in Montecito. I thought somebody had illegally paved in front of their property. As I was marching along the beach there, it went from sand to hardpan, and that's actually a mud layer that's several inches thick that was caked along, and you can, the tip-off was the footprints that I saw in it as I came down there, and that was around Oak Creek Mountain.
Before you leave that, I mean, you just got my curiosity raised here. The mud layer is a result of silt from the creek, or how did that mud layer get there?
Yeah, presumably that was the mud flows coming out. You know, what didn't come down into the neighborhoods, some of it came out through the creeks. We have no idea how much, but obviously enough to raise the creek level and deposit on the beaches around these creek mouths to a pretty significant extent, and this is what was left. And this was 2.5 months later.
Well, thanks.
Yeah, so next one. This is Arroyo Paradon over by Santa Claus Lane. We were a little surprised to see a lot of debris and stuff on the beach there because that's a little bit south of the main impact area. And the next one. This is off Rincon Creek. This was kind of a surprise too. This was to the south. We were down there finishing our Carpinteria survey and there was a lot of sand there on the beach. And these boulders out in the line up there that the surfers, pretty much every single one I talked to was complaining about this, that they're now a hazard in the surf zone. These came from the riprap protecting the houses inland along the creek mouth there. So high flows, we don't again know how much material came out, but enough to move these big boulders. Okay, next slide. Okay, so just a little background. Most of you guys are really familiar with this, I'm sure. This was the Thomas Fire, biggest one in history. This is the December 25th map showing the progression of the fire from down around Ventura inland and then up to the north up here and into the areas that then created the conditions for the mud flows. Next slide. Not a lot of stream gauges in the area to monitor. We were looking at these as this event happened and watching these stream gauges. Carpinteria Creek is actually the one most central in the area impacted. You can see it came up 12 feet in 30 minutes. All you guys, I'm sure, have been down and seen the stream channel there after all the work to clear it out. Ventura River, which is well inland, came up 8 feet in 15 minutes. And there was a gauge further up in that watershed that also came up in Mutilaja, came up pretty rapidly. So obviously a lot of water coming down really fast in there. Next slide. And then the mud flows, which you guys have seen millions of pictures of, so there's not a lot in here. A little picture of Highway 101 down there. But the main drainage is that it came down where it wasn't jumping the banks were the Montecito, San Isidro, and Romero Creeks. And you'll see those highlighted on the next slides as we go through and look at the coastal part. Next slide. So you can actually get a thing called Digital Globe now. I don't know if any of you guys have seen this. You can get satellite images. You can sign up and go look at areas repeatedly over time. So we'll just flip through these. This is December 26th. This is after the fires. And you can see the stream mouse tag there. And the next slide, if you click that one, you can see the muddy water. If you zoom in, you can actually see the mud in the neighborhoods. You can't see it here, but if you want to go in and analyze, you can use these to actually go in and look at where things, where mud accumulated. And then we'll flip through these over time and look forward. Next slide, 111, still muddy. Next slide, 112, starting to clear out a little bit. Next slide, 228, pretty clear. This is when we brought our big boat down and did some detailed surveys off of that area and off of Loon Point. Pretty good conditions. Next slide. 327, this is when we were here to do our surveys, our spring surveys, and there had been another rain event about a week before that, so the water got muddy again as more stuff was getting flushed out. Next slide. And then this is almost the most recent one. Things are looking pretty good these days in June. Next slide. So this is just an outline of the stuff that we've been doing since the mud flows. All of our normal stuff, but we've added some things. I'll talk about these each more in a little detail in the following slides, so I won't go into a lot of detail here. Added some big boat surveys, did our regular surveys with added lines in areas that look like they might have been impacted by the mud flows. And then the bottom two items there, the cliff erosion and the groundwater stuff, are larger scale projects that have been ongoing that are relevant to your region that we've got some results on. Next slide. All right, so this will highlight where we've actually added stuff. So you've seen this slide before. This is our overall survey area in the littoral cell. These white boxes are our normal focus areas. We added a new one here, the red one in Montecito, in the spring. That's where the big boat surveys happen and where we added a bunch of jet ski bathymetry work and some beach topography work to look at the actual areas where the material is coming out of the creeks. And we also added where the red stars are here up in Goleta, where the nourishment happened on the beach there. We did a little extra surveying off the beach there to make sure we can track that material. And then down here, Carpinteria Creek and off Rincon, those creeks that showed potential for significant discharge, we added some survey lines around there, so we'll get a little more data going forward there. Next slide. This is what the survey areas actually look like. These blue areas are the areas that the big boat surveyed, and I'll show you that data in a second. We came in after that and used that data. They had identified in these green patches here areas where it looked like there might have been deposition. So that's why we added the high density lines in on top of all those to come back with the jet skis and look at those in more detail. These stars up here are the stream mouths. This one over here in the corner is not a stream mouth. That's Olive Mill Road. That was on the off chance that there had been stuff coming down Olive Mill Road that actually made it into the ocean there, just for a reference point. When we looked at it later with this swath data, didn't look like much had gotten in there. They'd cleaned it up pretty much by the time we got there, so we didn't put closely spaced lines in there. Down off Goleta Beach, this is where all these squiggly red lines are the actual tracks of the jet skis. What we did there is we just went in between our normal, the green lines here, and added lines in between each on 50 meter spacing, so we'd have better resolution of this area in front of the nourishment. Out here in Carpinteria, around Carpinteria Creek, we already had a line right on the creek, and we added four more lines, two on either side in there. Rincon Creek, here we added, and then Dave Hubbard, who we work with at UCSB, had been down surveying and seen some material off the culverts down here, so we added some lines off the culverts here. Although, to be honest, by the time we get that far down, these watersheds are pretty small, and we don't expect a lot of material to be coming out of those areas. There's also a couple further south there we didn't get to in this survey, but we expected to see most of the action up here in this area. Next slide. So this is what the big boat survey looks like. They've got the big million-dollar machine on there to look at the bottom, so you get these very high resolution maps of what's happening on the bottom. And the actual reason they went there was really to look for what they call hyperpycnal flows, high density flows that actually would have moved a significant distance offshore and deposited and created what they've seen before in some of the sort of geologic maps in the area, these lobes of sediment that can appear out at significant distances offshore. This material, if it arrives rapidly, it can travel very rapidly underwater and just sort of, it's almost like an avalanche moving offshore. And it creates these features that they'd seen some in these areas, which is why they came back to these areas. And it's reasonable to think that that happens for sure, given the topography and the drainage. And they wanted to see whether it had possibly happened this time. I would say from the preliminary data, it doesn't look like we saw that volume of material. It is hard to detect because even the geologic scale ones, you're typically looking at maybe a half meter thickness of a feature out there, which is a little hard to detect. That's not very big. But the equipment is pretty good. So they were looking for that, didn't necessarily see it, but in the process they got us very good high resolution maps at the bottom here. They also did some video surveys. The idea was to look for the actual material, but it was still so turbid when they were there that they couldn't see the bottom, so that didn't work. And they collected a bunch of sediment samples from various areas, primarily in what they hoped were the deposition areas. I don't have those data. If you want to contact me about those later, I can direct you to the people who have them, and we can follow up with that. Now, this is an auxiliary product we can get from the big boat work. This is backscatter. This is basically the intensity of the sound return coming off the bottom. It is not quantitative, but it gives you some indication of possibly what you're looking at, and using this in conjunction with the bathymetry and other data sediment samples, you can get some information. So typically, the bright white areas are strong returns. Often that's bedrock. Sometimes it's a rough bottom where it's scattering the return, so it's bright. The dark stuff is a weak return, probably mud. So you can see off the stream mouse in here, there's some areas here that may be mud, maybe mud, maybe mud here. They match up with the locations of the stream mouse. Not a lot happening down off Loon Point. There is a little drainage right here, but it doesn't drain a lot of area. I'll show you a picture later where there is evidence of some activity there, but we don't see a lot in the actual backscatter. Then what was really actually interesting to the guy who processes this was actually these light white areas here, these brighter areas here, which we're not sure what they are, but they look like real features. And his thought was they may be sand, because sand can be a little more reflective than the other bottom materials. So we'll see what happens with the sediment samples on that, but we're still working with this data set. All right, next slide. So the jet ski bathymetry, we survey, it's a single beam system, so we survey along preset lines. That's all these lines I showed you before along here. So this is what happens when I take all that data, combine it together into a point cloud, and then generate a surface from it, which is what this colored surface is here. So what we're doing now is we're comparing this surface from the jet skis to the surface that the big boat got in this area and this area. And there's a little offset. I'm still trying to figure out what is. What's up with that? It's about 15 centimeters. But that's going to allow us to see if there was any change between our survey and their survey. And then that'll give us the baseline for future surveys to go in and look for change. If there was material that came out in these areas, we should see it start to move away in subsequent surveys this fall, next spring as we go forward. As I said, we also collected additional data off Goleta Beach and Carpinteria Creek to look for changes there. I have not actually processed that to look for the changes yet, so that's pending. I mentioned earlier that to one of your colleagues here that doing the beach work is the easiest part. You know, we survey the beaches and it's pretty easy for us to pull out the shorelines, so we were able to update the shorelines to the most recent survey, which was this last spring. So this is the cycle we've seen regionally, up and down. You see a spring and fall change. Usually in the spring after the winter, the beaches have retreated, and in the summer they move out, so by fall they're wider. This red area is new since you last saw this, and what's noteworthy here is there has been some recovery. We saw the El Nino crash here, and then we saw some movement around in here, and we had some storms. And we have seen some recovery, some upward movement here. In the Santa Barbara, the green here, it had stayed down, and then it came up as expected last fall, but then it didn't go down this spring, which is highly unusual. In fact, this little bar down here, this is the erosion anomaly percent. What percent of the erosion did we see this winter compared to the previous winter? And this one is actually at minus 101%. So that means it went positive. This is not due to nourishment. I've taken the nourishment effect out of this. It's not due to Montecito, because Montecito isn't in this time series because it's the first time we surveyed it. It's more likely that what we're seeing down here is this decrease in wave energy and erosion simply allowed more sand to migrate back up onto the beaches. And it's been hammered for so many years that there probably has been some sand stored offshore. Don't hold me to that. You know, we haven't figured it out yet. But before we invoke some magical thing, I think probably what's happened is we just had a really low wave energy year here, and we've seen some sand move back up onto the beaches here, and in particular in Santa Barbara. Next slide. So this updates another slide you saw last May. This is the Goleta area here. Here's the Goleta Pier. This is the area that's been armored and then was nourished. This blue line here is the most recent contour here, and you can see the bulge out here where the nourishment has pushed it out a bit. It's still quite a ways back, nowhere near where it's been historically. And it's worth noting that over here along the bluffs, you can see the purple line was the previous fall, and then it retreated as expected to this blue line in the spring. So the behavior over here is more what you'd expect in a normal winter. But out here, it's been pushed out a little bit by the nourishment. We'll see how that evolves over time. I'll also just the photographs here. These photographs were in the previous one. That was the scarping, the bluffs here. This is spring 2018, and this is what it looks like in 2016, and then spring 2018. It looks like a normal beach. It's not as wide as it's been historically. So, next slide. Okay, so this is John Warwick stuff. I mentioned this last time. We've got an airplane that he flies with cameras and GPS gear that allows him to basically generate three-dimensional surfaces from successive photographs of an area. This is not a 3D image, but this is the area in Potter that I mentioned here. First of all, we've got reference flights. The last full reference flight was last March. Then right after the fire in December, he did fly just the Rincon to Ventura stretch. And then after the floods, we came in and did a full flight, and we did some extra coverage that I'll show you of the areas that likely contributed to the mud flows. And then coincident with our spring survey, he did another flight on March 29th, so we can compare his data to ours on the beaches. So this was kind of interesting. This is Pottero here. This is the March 1st, 2017 slide. And then if you hit the next slide, the next one will come in after the flood. So it's not a perfect registration, but what you can see here is there are actually boulders on the beach here. And you know, we expect some gulling, but the surprise was to see in this small watershed some significant boulders down here on the beach, like we saw at Rincon. So there was material moving even in small watersheds, apparently. Next slide. Now these are true 3D images generated from his work in here. This is the extra coverage. He had our guy fly in the burn area here. And this is, they're pretty excited about this. They're sharing this with our colleagues in Golden, Colorado, who are actually landslide people, and they're super excited about this opportunity to go in and get very fine detail on changes in the landscape. So this is the big picture. This is a slightly smaller scale where you can actually narrow down onto the drainage channel at the bottom. And this is even finer where you can see rilling and gulling in the faces of these features here. So for landscape geomorphologists, this is like, you know, Christmas. This is amazing stuff. So they're going to be working with this, and I'm sure that John will be continuing to fly and try to use this to essentially use Montecito as a chance for them to really get a handle on how these types of events are triggered and how they evolve over time. Next slide. Then this, I'm just going to touch briefly on two of the big picture things that have been going on, not related to Montecito. I talked last time about the whole Cosmos effort, the coastal flooding modeling work that's been going on. This is related to that. We've had an effort going on trying to look at how cliffs will respond over time and predict how they will evolve. Pat Limber's been leading that, and he's finished that work up and published that. So I've sort of snipped out a piece here to show you. I blocked off all of, you know, Ventura and LA down here because you don't care about that. Santa Barbara's up here, and this color coding here shows you what they're predicting for 2 kilometer stretches along the coast for cliff retreat under various sea level scenarios. And you see this big one down here is over 100 meters by 2100. And over here shows you, this is the Santa Barbara section, and this is different levels of sea level rise, you know, low, medium, and high. Although, to be fair, saying that 2 meters of sea level rise now is the high version, there are people who are arguing it's going to get bigger than that. You know, there's still significant uncertainties with this. Clearly, cliff retreat, like beach erosion, is going to increase with sea level rise. The rate down here is roughly double what the historical rates have been, and that's on average. So this is an average 19 to 41 meters by 2100, but that's not at the 2 kilometer scale. So I can't tell you exactly what that red dot is right in there. It looks like somewhere around Montecito, but I could get a hold of Pat and find out exactly what that means. Next slide. And this is the last thing that we've been working on, a new effort. There's been a lot of interest in groundwater along the coast, and this possibility that as sea level rises in areas where groundwater is actually floating on the underlying seawater, which is very common in places like Hawaii and atolls, but also happens here along the coast in some areas, it's going to lift up. As sea level rises, that groundwater surface is going to lift up as well. So in low-lying coastal areas, groundwater that was underground eventually will come out of the ground. And before it comes out of the ground, it's going to get shallower, and when you're digging or you have infrastructure down there, it's going to be underwater instead of dry. So we got a hold of a guy, Kevin Beefus, at the University of Wyoming up here, who had done some work on the East Coast looking at very broad-scale groundwater modeling and came up with a way to try to do this for the entire California coast. So he's actually finished that up. So we will be generating maps for the entire California coast that show inundated areas under different sea level rise conditions, areas that are from 0 to 1 meter depth, and I think from 2 to 3 meters depth groundwater. So we can get an idea of where the hot spots are, where people should be concerned about the possibility of this happening. So that's going to come out. Hopefully we're going to get that data online in November. Next slide. Okay. So I won't go through all this stuff. This just reiterates pretty much everything I just talked about. We are continuing to do our normal spring and fall surveys. We're going to do one this September or early October. We will be trying to continue to do the Montecito work. This last spring, we actually did not do part of the Rincon surveys so that we were able to have time to do the Montecito bathymetric surveys. We don't normally do bathymetric surveys in the spring. We'll see how long we're able to continue to do that. All of this work is basically bootlegged because we're interested in the process and trying to understand what's going on. So we'll continue to try to do that. We don't have an exact plan for that. But in talking to people here before the meeting, obviously there's a lot of interest in this on your end as well as our end. So we will be trying to continue these surveys. And just a, you know, the red thing down at the bottom also came up in discussion this morning. I mentioned this last May. Pretty much the consensus of the climate change models is that we're going to have more droughts, which all of you I'm sure already know. So there's more potential for extreme fires. And we have this possibility of more intense El Nino events and more intense rainfall events. So the conditions that led to the Thomas Fire and the mud flows are probably not going away. They're probably getting worse. So I'm glad you guys are thinking about it because we do need to be planning for that eventuality. That's all I have.
Do you have any information on what that might do to saltwater intrusion into the groundwater basin itself?
The answer is no. Saltwater intrusion is, if you're asking the question, you're probably familiar with how difficult it is to work with saltwater intrusion. And that is probably the most common question we get when groundwater comes up. To do saltwater intrusion work, you really need to do a local model to really understand the local geology and the local hydrology. And that is expensive and difficult, and even then, the results are a little sketchy. So there are people that do it. We're not trying to do that with this. This is more just looking at that possibility of the groundwater coming out of the ground.
That issue would be of great interest to not only the city, but our local water agency as well. Is that at a level where it, you could do a presentation to the local agencies on what that kind of a projection means?
That will be coming out in November because this is time to come out with the next phase of the Cosmos coastal modeling work to come out in conjunction with that. So I would suspect very strongly that Patrick and Juliet Finzi Hart, who's our outreach coordinator, will be folding that into the outreach efforts with that to get that word out. I will say preliminarily, since I don't always like to be the bearer of bad news, from what I've seen of Kevin's results, the areas where it's likely to be a serious issue are pretty restricted. There are significant uncertainties with that, but it depends on the local geology. So obviously we pick an example that is splashy and makes a good picture. Hopefully there won't be a lot of issues at your house or, you know, places that are immediately of concern here, but that data should be coming out in November.
Well, that's whenever that's ready, I'm sure that you know, we'd like to have a presentation on that.
Sure.
I know we've got some issues, you know, with our friends at the city of Oxnard. We share the wastewater treatment plant, which is right on the coast. I mean, in our county, is all over the state. We're looking at water management plans. There's questions of how much upper aquifer water we can use. Is that available? If it's going to be displaced, you know, as Mr. Bennett's question, seawater intrusion is always an issue with us. If we're going to have artesian flooding,
yeah,
I mean, that's an issue as well. So we've got a lot of very specific local issues, and you put that map up there, so you open the door. Whenever that's ready.
Yeah.
We'd very much like to have a local presentation on
that. Yeah, we'll keep you in the loop. And that really is the point of this, is to focus those other efforts, is to say, you know, if you need to go in and do a detailed groundwater model to look at intrusion or the possibility of effects, a lot of these areas, particularly for this issue, in my opinion, are not that expensive to go get the data to really resolve whether there is an issue or not. You can put in some very simple groundwater monitoring wells that are just looking at water level. You're not even doing water quality. I've always been hopeful in a way that a lot of the agencies that deal with construction in cities would have this data somewhere because people have been out there digging foundations and have some idea where the water table is. But there's no way for us to aggregate that data. But if this focuses a city or a region to where they say, hey, you know, we think there might be an issue here, let's go collect the data on our own, then that will hopefully trigger that.
So I just have a question on how closely you're looking at the value of the nourishment, and if you, in the course of looking at all the topography, if you've seen any other places along the south coast that would have as much or close to as much benefit vis-a-vis nourishment other than Goleta Beach. You know, that's one thing the county is trying to wrestle with is maybe, you know, if there's an emergency, either have a shared burden or have other alternatives. And anything in your course of work that encounters that or that
I would
makes
have to
you
say,
have guesses along those
yeah,
lines?
You know, off the top of my head, I would say no. You know, obviously, with all the caveats that I'm not going back and looking at the data, but obviously, Goleta Beach has been such an outlier. It was that spring 2014 storm that came in there and just tore the beach out. You know, it put sailboats on the beach. It, you know, went in through the restaurant at the base of the pier. And we were there right before and right after that surveying the beach. And that was really unusual. Just that the direction of that wave event coming in was highly unusual. Doesn't mean it's not going to happen again, but the effects have been long-lasting there. Other areas in general have come and gone, but, you know, the Santa Barbara littoral cell, for the most part, not a lot of sand moving compared to some of the areas we work in. The outlier to that would be down around Santa Clara, where you have a lot of wave energy, and you've got Santa Clara River coming out. That area is just extremely dynamic because of the river. So if we get a flood, we get a delta like we did in 2004, and then it erodes away, and then the waves come in and attack. And, you know, a couple years ago, there was erosion right up to the parking lot there almost. I almost couldn't drive south to do our surveys. So when you mention that, that's the first thing that pops to mind, but that is such a dynamic area with the river right there that, I mean, I think that's the nature of the beast there. Probably the best thing to do is, if you really want to know, would be actually go back and look through the data and see if there are areas. But off the top of my head, I guess the answer would be no.
Okay.
Yeah.
Member.
Thank you. There was one slide, I maybe should have interrupted at the time, but it was a slide of Goleta Beach, and it had a lot of red vertical lines.
Mm-hmm.
Can you just explain what that represented?
The red lines were showing the actual path of the jet ski, where we surveyed. So what we normally do is we survey. Yeah, if you just keep going back, it's quite a ways.
Yeah.
Keep going. Yeah. Keep going.
Remember.
There you go.
Okay. There it is, right there.
Yeah, so go forward and away.
Right there.
Yeah. So the blue lines are where we're trying to survey. So we try to survey along the same line each time because the echo sounder is just like a straight laser beam that goes to the bottom. So what we try to do is survey exactly on the same line each time so we can compare from survey to survey if there's changing along that line. What we did in this case was, because we knew there was this extra material on the beach, is we just added a line. We looked on the computer and said, we're going to drive 50 meters off of that previous line. And then we filled in those red lines in between there. So we have more data density, more coverage. So when I turn that into the same kind of three-dimensional map that you saw from Montecito,
mm-hmm.
it'll actually make sense. Instead of interpolating 100 meters across from line to line, I'm going 50 meters, which is a little more reasonable for that.
Okay.
Yeah.
We have had nourishment, you know, which we typically understand as being something positive and good that we've either taken from Goleta Slough or East Beach or other riverbeds. This wasn't, I wouldn't necessarily say that this would be, that the definition of nourishment would apply to what happened in this event. It certainly did have an effect on the width of the beach, but what we've been trying to talk about in the county is that this is not necessarily the same type of nourishment that we would like to see, especially since the beach was closed and just recently, so it's almost been 7 months, the beach has been closed and just recently opened to a warning status. So it is a little bit different, and I think the distinction should be needs to be made, just in general.
Do you have another name for it?
I don't have another name for it. I mean, we call it, you know, it was the mud flow, and the debris was, you know, came to Goleta Beach. So you can call it what you want, but I wouldn't necessarily say that it was nourishment as we know that term. Because we have done nourishment there.
Okay. All right.
Deposition.
That would be.
Member Ramirez.
I do have a question. Maybe you might not have the answer, Mr. Hoover, but do we know have any information about the impact on the fisheries or the life in the water? Who would be looking out for that?
That's a good question. one of the conversations I was having before the meeting was that there is no real integrated response that I know of to try to tie together all the different things that are going on here. We work in the area, we saw what was happening, so we started adding things to what we could do. There are researchers at UC Santa Barbara, probably among other agencies, who are involved. It would be really nice if some agency who does coordination could get everybody together to make sure we know what's going on, because I don't know of any work going on there.
Well, I will say, just to follow up, because at Goleta Beach, because of the beach closure, that there was an advisory against people fishing off of the pier and eating shellfish in that area.
Would Fish and Wildlife be a source for that? Do you guys ever talk to each other?
We do, but not a lot. I mean, we're geologists. You know, we're coastal geologists.
I get it.
So we're happy to see each other and, you know, have a beer and say hello, but we don't have a lot to talk about.
That seems like a good project there.
Yeah.
Mr. Chair, if I might jump in for, excuse me, we just made a note of that, and certainly we'll follow up and see what UCSB, certainly if students or grad students are doing, because I know there was a lot of interest in following all through that, and Gerald and myself will follow up, and if it's Fish and Wildlife, to get an idea. Certainly one of the components of permitting and things along that is how does it affect, how much sediments are going to be put on when we're going for a permit, and not, as I would say, an epizootal emergency, whatever that word becomes, that's a little different, certainly. But in a permit process, we have to take that into account. So we'll find out, because it's something we're going to have to do in SICBIP, and something we should be aware of also as we go forward, especially at the bottom of the slide saying there's a good chance we're going to have more of these in the future. So thank you. I'm sorry, Mr. Chair.
The question I had was, and you probably mentioned it, how much material came down, ton-wise? Any ideas?
Yeah, I mean, the only actual good estimate that I know of is about the 100,000 cubic yards that was sitting on Highway 101. So more than that, I've heard a number of 1 million cubic yards put out that I think came from the county, but I haven't been able to track it back to any real agency.
That's a tremendous amount, millions of.
You know, it's very difficult to know, because, you know, we see the big boulders down at the base of the stream mouths, but we don't know the composition or the total volume of material that came out that carried those boulders. We don't know if they came from, you know, half a mile upstream, or they came from the riprap wall right at the mouth of the stream, like they did in Rincon, probably. And in a mud flow situation, you know, it's a really interesting scientifically problem, because you've created this very viscous, thick material that's actually very efficient at moving heavy objects, which we saw moving cars and houses and things. Mm-hmm. But the nature of the material is just completely unknown. And the mud goes out and disperses. The heavier stuff drops closer. That's what we're hopefully looking for here, is the heavier material. But for us, there are some bathymetry data from 2009 and 2006 in the area. We're not sure how good they are. So the data we just collected may be our best baseline for looking at future changes. So we're kind of a little late to the game, but hopefully we're going to see stuff continue to move.
In the future, when it rains again,
more will come in.
More will come in,
yeah,
too.
So that's another issue, is that there's a lot stored in the watershed that still is working its way down. So it's actually quite a daunting problem, mm-hmm, to really wrap your hands around. And I wish, that's one of the numbers, if you could give me a wish, yeah, to just have a wish granted, that would be one of the numbers I would like to know.
Interesting. Thank you.
Mm-hmm. Okay. And certainly for the members in Ventura County, south of those areas, the question is, having these, this amount of sediments over the next 5, 10 years, 15 years to make its way down the coastline and be able to, certainly in an El Nino winter, a lot of that sediment's getting pushed up on the beach and being utilized as both for beach and certainly protection as it works down, is certainly probably one of the only benefits that's come out of all of this. So.
Yeah, I mean, I think that's a good point, because this is how the system works. This is how it's supposed to work. I mean, this is a, you know, it's a Mediterranean, it's an episodic rainfall kind of environment, maybe not with the severity of the burns and the severity of the rainfall, but historically, when we started surveying here in 2005, we just missed the 2004 flood, which was the flood of record on the Santa Clara River, which had massive amounts of material come out, and actually Patrick and some colleagues wrote a paper looking at the volume of material that was deposited off the Santa Clara River mouth. So that was the first chance people had had to actually do that. Since then, there's been basically nothing. So this is the first time since then that we've had a significant, potentially significant sediment input. So we're hoping to see it. That's why we went out to get the baseline data, and why we surveyed in the spring when we generally don't. We'll just have to see how it goes over the next few years if we start to see changes that give us a hint of how much material landed there and then is moving hopefully down coast, as you point out.
Are you seeing the signs? Because, you know, surfers talk, but this is not backed up with any data. So is your data indicating that we may face an El Nino year in the coming? And so the Southern Oscillation is happening and all that stuff. So it will be interesting to see how much is retained, how much moves in the face of an El Nino.
That's why we do what we do. Absolutely. Yeah.
I'd like to introduce Glenn Shepard. Glenn's with Ventura County Watershed Protection District. And you got his little pointer.
And while Glenn's coming up, I won't miss the opportunity to say to the Board of Supervisors from Ventura that Glenn's input in the Koyama GSA has been really helpful because, you know, we're usually getting our butt kicked over there, and so having him make the drive all the way up to Koyama has been very, very helpful every month.
Thanks.
Thank you, Supervisor Williams. Good morning, Chair Sharkey, members of the board. Glenn Shepard, Watershed Protection District Director, which is a dependent district within the Public Works Agency. Happy to join you this morning. To contribute to this conversation, just a handful of slides to talk about Ventura County's sediment management within the district. Just to reacquaint you with our watersheds, the primary ones as they relate to Beacon, obviously the Ventura River watershed as it abuts and heads into the east end of Santa Barbara County. Our largest watershed, Santa Clara River watershed, and you can see it stretches all the way around Ventura River and begins in east Santa Barbara County, and that's the Sespe Creek that dumps into the Santa Clara River in Fillmore. So that's a tremendous watershed. And then the Cayagas watershed to the south. Malibu Creek watershed drains at Malibu, so that's in Los Angeles County. Next slide. There's a slide. This is the watershed's sediment storage remaining capacity, and unfortunately it's not very readable from afar. But we have sites, organic sites, that we have leases or fee-owned sites throughout the county. And below each site, you can see the cubic yards of remaining storage that we have today at some of these locations. The gray boxes highlight locations where we have contracted locations and the amount of storage that we can use there. The key site that I want to mention is in the Cayagas watershed that was mentioned before, which is along the Cayagas Creek, just upstream of the naval base, Ventura Naval Base down there. And that site, we have 250,000 cubic yards that are remaining at that site. We're in the process of actually converting a leased real estate agreement to a fee purchase real estate agreement that will come to our Board of Supervisors for approval here in the future. But the capacity of that site is 500,000 cubic yards. So it's a large site as it contributes to your all's discussion about where you can store and perhaps sort. But it's a good location. And this past year, we've been entertaining some discussion with the Navy base as they look to perhaps do some level of effort on their beaches. And obviously, that's a federal entity that you all may want to help contribute to that conversation as it goes forward, dealing with a federal property that has a beachfront and perhaps a receptor site.
Glenn, if I could just jump in. Cayagas Creek is certainly at the very far end of the Beacon pipeline, so to speak, but it's beach quality sand. It's amazing, but it's at the end of the watershed, so the ability to transport it up or do something with it is going to be. Also, Broad Beach has been looking at possibly that being one of the sites to maybe be able to get sand replenishment for the Broad Beach problem they have down there. So,
Mr. Chair,
I just wanted to add that.
Ask something, John. I'm not sure. Can RDB 21 work with Regional Defense Plan work with the naval base regarding that? That's helping the naval base.
Well, John, a little off topic here, but I've tried to get RDP 21 interested in that issue because it costs the Navy $400,000 a year. Their contribution to the Channel Islands maintenance dredging. The Navy you know, for those who haven't been following things, we had our shortage of replenishment at Wainimi Beach. The void itself is moving down towards Point Magoo. So, and I pointed that out to an undersecretary of the Navy when he came out to visit. So whether, you know, the Cayuga sand gets used to filling that void at the end or not, I mean, I would rather put it up at the beginning of Wainimi Beach, which isn't that much further away, and then it would benefit our beach and then work its way down coast. But they've got to deal with the void that was created by congressional malfeasance, let's be honest about it. And whether that's an important issue for the exigent issue for them right now or not, I can't say. But I'd love to see RDP get a little more involved with this because it is an actual cost to the Navy. Yeah,
Beacon would be happy to engage and give a presentation if you got the invitation.
It's important because you know we lobby for the bases quite right. a bit, and RDP 21 is really listened to in DC. You know, so that's something to, maybe to think about.
Thank you. Okay,
I may mention one thing. And Glenn can correct me, but the design of most of these debris basins is traditional in that it does not allow sediment to flow in its
function. That's correct. This is a mechanical removal and replacement, whether it becomes beach nourishment or placement nearby. And back just to corroborate Santa Barbara, you know, it's a least cost to the taxpayer scheme. So we look to have storage or agreements with landowners that are adjacent or very near to affect the least cost for transportation and replacement of the sediment. And so we can focus most of the money into the actual removal and management of the basins.
Because of how well the Gobernador Canyon debris basin worked, right? You know, all the fish people wanted us to start cutting fish passage notches into our debris basins. And for a while, our flood control was very freaked out that this would not be good, but it turns out it was enormously effective at dealing with this event because it let more smaller grain stuff through and blocked all the boulders instead of our traditional basins that got filled up with mud and then didn't block the boulders. And so we are planning on redesigning those debris basins to have notches cut in them to allow the sand, mud, smaller grain sediment to go downstream, and as a possible consequence, it might let some fish go upstream. But at this point, our primary motivation for doing that work is not even the fish, it's just it's a more effective debris basin design in the opinion of our flood control director.
I did want to say that Beacon wrote a letter of support, and Santa Barbara County went after and got a grant to look at retrofitting, and Beacon about 3-year board okayed a letter to go out to that just because it did allow sediments to flow through and trap a lot of the big stuff. So thank you. Glenn, if you want to continue.
Sure, just a couple notes here. The fire actually came at a good time for us, and I know there's a silver lining there in most things, and this was the case here as we were prepared for the rainy season just ahead of the fire. Fire came on December 4th, as everyone remembers. We were done with preparations for the rain, so we had capacity both organically to the organization, and our contractor capacity was available to do extra post-storm efforts, which I'll show you here in a second. So a little note there, we did almost 37,000 cubic yards of extra sediment removal in the burn areas just after the fire. Our average sediment removal efforts almost 180 cubic yards a year. And at the bottom there, it's cut off, but total basin sediment capacity is at 1.7 million cubic yards. Next slide. Just to highlight flood control, but more important, erosion. This is Royal Simi up in Moore Park, just around the high school. We lost a couple of stabilizers, which hold back and retain sediment before it goes. And in this case, we lost some stabilizers, which affected some erosion in the channel. And I just wanted to highlight the fact of when our watersheds, just like in Santa Barbara County, are very fast and swift, and so these stabilizers are in place to help retain and control erosion in the channel and manage sediment as it moves towards the ocean. Next slide. We're talking about assets, and here's our big asset, Matilha Dam, you're all probably familiar with. Just wanted to put it here and talk about how much sediment's behind there. 6 to 8 million cubic yards, we believe, is behind it. There's water flowing over the dam now, and we believe the sediment capacity there remains around 1 million cubic yards to go before we will change the name of Matilha Dam to perhaps Matilha Meadow. Pole Creek, this is one of our largest debris basins near Fillmore. It's about 400,000 cubic yard capacity. Next slide. I tried a new product for channel control. This is an alluvial area east of Ojai in an open field, and there's a big development on the east side, county unincorporated, and we're trying a new HESCO barrier wall to help control the creek so it's manageable heading into the Thatcher Creek. Next slide. Basin channel cleanouts. This is in the city of Ventura. Next slide. Through NRCS, we installed several of these big bollard systems throughout the upper reaches of up above Ojai in particular. You can see the steep canyons here. This is intended to stop the big boulders upstream in particular. There's several locations that actually go through the city of Ojai, and of course, they're very concerned with the big boulders. The perspective there, they're 6 feet out of the ground, and they're 3 feet on center. Filled with concrete. And subject to your questions, that was my presentation.
Just one, I mean, you saw that picture of Matilha Dam, and we just saw the grand jury report on conditions of dams in Ventura County, and I saw they listed Matilha Dam as being not in very good shape, which we know because we've been trying to take the damn thing down for how many years now? I know Mr. Bennett, you're more involved with that than I am, but what's the status on the Matilha Dam issue?
We had one removal option that we were running through the Army Corps and the federal government. We even we were in the WERDA bill, that removal option meant a small amount of the sediment was going to be left up there behind the dam. People objected to that, and as soon as there was objection, because the whole thing that was selling it in Washington, it was that everybody was on board. We had the environmentalists, everybody on board. When that objection was raised in Washington in a letter signed by quite a few organizations, the federal support just evaporated. And so we went from almost having it funded, and we were through WERDA and everything else, and that was when the Democrats were controlling Congress, and we had a real chance. So when that happened, all that federal funding stopped, and now the project has restarted trying to get state funding and private funding to remove the dam, and you can imagine that's much more difficult. About six years, a new idea surfaced that theoretically will not leave the sediment up there, and that would work. And so now the coalition of support is back unified again. But the question is, where's the funding going to come from? And so it's there's some funding in the state water bond that is out there that doesn't specifically call out Matilha Dam, but the qualifications are such that Matilha Dam would rank high, but that won't be all of the funding that's needed. So it's a matter of trying to get the funding, one. And then the other thing I would offer to you, this new plan only can happen under certain climate conditions. The river has to be at a certain level, the lake, the reservoir has to be at a certain level, Lake Acetus it's diverted into. You have to have all of those things work, and then you have to have a certain size storm, and then you blow the bottom of the dam. And so those conditions may take a long time to develop also. So that's where we are with the dam.
I was just concerned when I saw that grand jury report that somebody's not going to take that as oh, we better fix the damn thing. You know, that just takes us in the wrong direction.
Nobody's going to fix it. The question will be, who's going to have the liability for emergency removal if that ever gets required? And that would be a shame for the local taxpayers to suddenly be stuck with that liability.
We have Matt Roberts from the city of Carpinteria. Matt, thank you for being here.
Thank you. Good morning, Mr. Chair, members of the Beacon Board. I'll be very brief. My name is Matt Roberts, and I am the city of Carpinteria's Parks and Recreation Director, and I've been the beach manager for more years than I would be like to admit, actually. My perspectives of how this event went this last winter, I was going to show you a picture, if we can, of the city beach.
What's the website?
As you saw earlier from Maureen's presentation, I think the city beach was the receiver site for some 28 or 26,000 cubic yards of sediment that came from the Carpinteria salt marsh. And that's a black, very fine material. I'm not sure how the sieve analysis went on that in terms of how much was considered beach sand. I think I might have heard as much as half of it. In addition to that, they hydraulically dredged material and put it just west of Carpinteria City Beach at the mouth of the slough, or the mouth of the marsh. And I think that was another 26,000 yards. So we did have an event where emergency deposition of sediments it was over 50,000 cubic yards. And so how did that behave on our beach? What did it do? There was the nuisance factor, certainly, of the trucking and the water quality. Unlike Goleta, it cleaned up when that deposition ended. The water quality came back very quickly. And so I don't think that was anything different than natural conditions. Really, if we had a lot of rain, we have a lot of bacterial contaminant getting in the ocean. I don't believe that any of that was really beyond what was a natural condition. But right now, our beach has a really nice inventory of sand. It is true also because I am the person who does the winter flood protection and builds the winter berm. I know that if the winter berm is not eroded at all over the course of the winter, it was a pretty mild winter. And even though we had this tragedy of January 9th, we didn't have a big surf year, and the berm was almost 100% intact at the end of the winter. There are years when we have a high energy winter, and I have to rebuild that berm several times under emergency circumstances to keep the protection level up. Since the last 4 or 5 years, we have not had that problem. The berm has been very, very resilient and not threatened. The sand inventories are high because of that. But there is a problem, and I wish I could get the picture up, because you look at the picture today of the beach, and it's just gorgeous. A wide, white, sandy beach.
Ash Street was a disposal site, right?
Ash Street was a disposal site. The deposition process has to be managed correctly so that you don't have residual effects, especially as it falls into the beach season. And like I say, the bacteriological loading was an issue, but it went away when it stopped, in our case, pretty much right away. The point I'm trying to make, though, is, and I so love to come to a meeting and address a board when I agree with all of you folks. It's great. the Santa Monica debris basin, the Gubernadora debris basin, those are sediments that were intended in a natural process to get to our coastline. They weren't intended to be intercepted and trucked. The material that the flood control deposited on our beach was that material that passed those debris basins. It's full of fines. It doesn't have the cobbles in it. Our big, wide, sandy beach looks great to the the person who's not thinking beyond that, but it's just sand. And I've done this long enough to tell you that we used to have a very large inventory of cobble under that sand.
That's right.
That cobble stratifies. It behaves differently in a high-energy environment. Sand lays down. A cobble gets thrown up and becomes more of a cusp, and the run of the wave gets intercepted by cobble. It's a huge beneficial energy dissipator. Mm-hmm. I've witnessed this. I may not have a degree in oceanography, but I'm an excellent witness. And the debris basins, which are so close to our beach, are intercepting all those coarse materials, and they should not. And I think it's essential that we look at how to restore those natural conditions. And I always run into folks who are regulators, and they say, well, cobble's wrong on the beach. And it just baffles me, because actually, that's where it would go otherwise, in Carpinteria especially, where the watershed is steep and so close to our coastline. So there's no reason why somebody shouldn't be evaluating that process with, and I think the best thing to say is, we want to restore natural conditions. Those debris basins solved a big problem. They've been in place for about 50 years now. And we're now starting to see the sediment character changing on our beach from that cobble that was the stratus underneath the sand to just sand. That heavy, wide beach sand is going to have less resiliency in a high-energy environment. So I applaud your direction. I think economic analysis would demonstrate that it's more efficient, than more beneficial for public policy. It's even in the Army Corps' mandate that they have to do the most cost-effective thing. I can't see how that could possibly be trucking it to Ventura or to Buellton. And it belongs to us. It doesn't belong to Ventura or a Buellton. It belongs to the Carpentaria shoreline. So those debris basins did solve a problem of flooding of the residential areas, but they've created a new one that will also lead to the loss of homes if we don't change our practices.
Okay, thank you. Any questions, comments? I will say, you know, Dr. Baylor did an excellent presentation to the Coastal Commission on the sediment deposition from the recent incidents, and seemed to make an impression. But then, you know, we just had another ruling where some people apparently didn't understand that, so there's more education that needs to be done. Thanks. Appreciate your comments, and yeah, we're all working for that.
And the only thing I would add under my executive director's report, to keep it short, I'm continuing to going after grants.
And I just want to thank you for the excellent work on the whole staff.
I will say that the focus of Beacon has been very narrow. It's getting even narrower. And I think the biggest thing we learned out of this is a lesson is to be able to have pre-sites of where when the sediments do come, we need to be able to hold on to them.
And planning for the future, I think.
That's all we're going to do, see if we can help our that way. Thank you.
If there's no further business and without objection, we will adjourn. Our next meeting was scheduled for September 21, 2018 at 9 a.m. or soon thereafter in these chambers. And with that, well, thank you, one, thank you all. We are adjourned.
Great. Enjoy the rest of summer. Thank you.